بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين My dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We spoke yesterday about preparation for Hajj. We covered things that we need to take care of before going to Hajj. We mentioned making taqleed. If I have not picked, can we put the, okay, no, just put them there. Just put them there, no problem. Making taqleed, picking a marji', scholar who is qualified to be a marji', a mujtahid, who is a qualified, who is known to be the most knowledgeable in jurisprudence. We need to, if we owe any khums or zakat, we have to pay our due khums and zakat. Writing will. Hajj Hiba is telling me that Sister Zainab is bringing the will forms. They will be in Arabic and in English. No need for any donation or any fees. They are given to you for free. So as soon as we get them, you can get your copy. And Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. The fourth thing we mentioned was forgiving others and seeking forgiveness. الأمور اللي ذكرناها قبل الذهاب إلى الحج أن أقلد مرجعا إذا مش مقلد أن أسدد ما بذمتي من خمس إذا أنا مطلوب خمس أو زكاة وكتابة الوصية راح تجي الوصية هون بعد شوي اللي يحب ياخذ نسخة مجانا وأن أسامح وأتسامح قبل الذهاب إلى الحج اليوم نحكي عن الحج نفسه Today we'll be talking about Hajj itself. Before I begin, write down this date. It's a crucial date. Crucial date. It is September 22nd. September 22nd. Also keep it September 23rd. September 24th, September 25th. So keep these dates, starting with September 22nd, because we are going to go back to them. It's very important that you keep this date in mind. سجلوا هذا التاريخ يوم 22 سبتمبر, 23 سبتمبر, 24 سبتمبر, 25 سبتمبر. مهم جدا أنه نخلي في بالنا هالتاريخ. طيب. لما نروح للحاج احنا قسمين انتوا قسمين قسم يروحوا للمدينة اول شيء ثم الى مكة وقسم يروحوا الى مكة ثم الى المدينة all those who go to Hajj they will be going to Mecca and Medina all but some of you will go depending on your itinerary and the group you're going with some of you will go to Mecca first, and then Medina, and some of you will go to Medina first, then to Mecca. Now, yeah, we need this. How many of you are going to Medina first? Do you know? Raise your hands high so I can see you. One, two, three, four, five. How many of you are going to Mecca first? عارفين؟ طيب. Hajj Hassan Subah Medina first. Hajj Nasif goes to Medina first. Hajj Hassan Amud goes to Medina first. So if you're going with one of these three, that means you're going to Medina first. Now, doing Hajj will not make a big difference, but there are a few small differences between doing Hajj first, going to Mecca first, because Hajj is in Mecca, and then going to Medina afterward, or vice versa, going to Medina first and going to Hajj second. وما في فرق كبير بس في فرق صغير بين الذهاب إلى المدينة أولا وبعدين إلى الحج. خلي نقول انه احنا رايحين اول شيء وين؟ على المدينة، بعدين نروح على مكة. Let's say you are of those who go to Medina first, then you go to Mecca. Then I will talk about those who go to Mecca first and then to Medina. Let us start with Medina first. So you will be traveling to Medina first. It could be September 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, sometime around that time. So when you go to Medina, basically this is how you're going to go. I assume most of you will go either to Lebanon or another transit country. From Lebanon, you will be flying to Medina. From Medina, you will be staying 3 to 4 days in Medina. You will be traveling with the bus to Mecca. Mecca is 420 kilometers south of Medina. Then, once you finish your Hajj in Mecca, you will be going to Jeddah. Jeddah is within 1 hour driving. You're talking about 100 kilometers, not too far from Mecca. You will be driving in the bus to Jeddah. You will be flying out of Jeddah home. So this is how we're going to be doing. Fly to Medina, go to Mecca, from Mecca go to Jeddah, and then fly back. For those who go where? To Medina first. اللي يروحون للمدينة أولاً هيك راح يروحوا. تروحون يمكن على لبنان أو الأردن أو أي دولة. منها تروحون على المدينة. أول ما تروحون تروحون على المدينة. تبقون بالمدينة يوماً ثلاثة. للمدينة تطلعون تروحون بالباص على وين؟ على مكة 400 كيلومتر. بعد ما تخلصون الحج تطلعون من مكة تروحون على وين؟ على جدة. ومن جدة تركبون الطائرة ترجعون على مدنكم. This is if you go to Medina first. But if you go to Mecca first, this is what's going to happen. You will not be flying to Medina. You will be flying to where? Jeddah. You will be going, you cannot go directly to Mecca. Why is that? Any clue? Why you cannot go from Jeddah to Mecca directly, even though it's too close? This is Jeddah, this is Mecca. We're talking about 100 kilometers. Why you cannot go directly? What's with the Ihram? Look, you cannot enter Mecca Hayallah. Mecca has 6 gates, imaginary gates, not real gates. Imaginary gates. Those gates are called what? Miqat. Meaning, for you to go to Mecca, you have to enter Mecca through one of these gates. So, if you're coming from Medina, there is a gate in Medina. It's called what? Masjid al-Shajara or Biar Ali. If you're going to Jeddah, there is no gate going straight from Jeddah to Mecca. The closest gate would be in a place called Juhfa. It is 200 kilometers south of Mecca. You need to travel to Juhfa or to Medina, but because you're in Jeddah, which one is the closer, Medina or Juhfa? Of course, Juhfa is the closer. So you will be driving, your Ma'arif will be taking you to Juhfa. From Juhfa, you will put your Ihram on, you will start your Umrah al-Tamattu', the first part of your Hajj, then you enter what? Then you enter Medina. This is how it's going to be if you go to Mecca first. You will be flying to Jeddah. From Jeddah, you will be driving to Juhfa. In Juhfa, there is nothing. There is a masjid. All you do, you wear your ihram, you enter Mecca, you go, you drive to Mecca. After finishing your Hajj in Mecca, after Hajj, you will be going where? To Medina. Once you finish Ziyarat al-Nabi, after Hajj, you will be driving back to Jeddah, and from Jeddah you will be flying back home. So basically, Hajj is the same. The only thing is will differ is what? How you're gonna enter Mecca. If you go to Medina first, you will be entering Mecca from which gate? Medina's gate, which is called Masjid al-Shajara, which is close to Mecca. But if you go to Mecca first, you will be going to Jeddah. From Jeddah, you drive to Juhfa. From Juhfa, you will be going to Mecca. That's the only difference. That's the time of travel. If you are traveling around 14 September, 15, that means you're going where? To Medina. If you go later, around 17 or 18, that means you're going to Mecca. So the earlier you go, that means you go to Medina. Because once you finish, you visit Medina and you finish your Hajj, you don't wait, you just come back home. But if you want to go to Medina, basically they go late, they go to Mecca first, finish their Hajj. After their Hajj, they don't come straight home, they go to Medina for 3 or 4 days, then they come back home. So this has nothing to do with you personally, this has to do with who? With Mu'arrif. Your Mu'arrif will decide whether you go to Mecca first or to Medina. It's not you. It's completely up to the Mu'arrif. Now, is there any afdaliyah, any superiority, any issue with going to Medina first or to Medina next? No. It doesn't matter at all. Whether you go to Medina first or to Mecca first, it doesn't matter. Your Hajj is the same. Now, let's assume we are going to Medina first. Hajj, go back to the. خلي نقول احنا رايحين اول شيء على المدينه من الناحيه الشرعيه ما في فرق سواء نروح على المدينه اول او على مكه الحج حج بس راح تتغير طريقه السفر فمشان اقرب المساله الى اذهانكم خلي نقول اول شيء وين رايحين على المدينه in order to make things clear for you let's imagine we're going to Medina first now the question is if someone goes to Hajj does he or she have to go to Medina Visiting Medina is mustahab, not wajib, but extremely mustahab. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says, "An hajj al bayt wa lam yazurni faqad jafani." Someone comes to Hajj and he does not visit me, he is showing disrespect to me. You fly all the way to Mecca, you do your Hajj, you don't go and visit the Prophet. Let me give you a very simple example. Now you're going to Hajj. In your way to Hajj, you stop in Lebanon. Your father lives in, let's say, in Sur. You go to Beirut, you stay 3 days in Beirut, and then you go to Mecca. You will not go and visit your parents in Sur. When your parents find out that you were in Beirut for 3 days, you did not bother to go and visit them, will not they be offended? We go to Mecca to do Hajj, but we'll not go to visit the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. That's why it's highly recommended to go to Medina. Even though it is not part of your Hajj, it is not mandatory, but it is highly recommended to go to Medina, whether before Hajj or after Hajj. الذهاب إلى المدينة ليس واجب ولكنه استحب لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وآله قال من حج البيت ولم يزرني فقد جفاني. طيب. احنا هلا بدنا نروح على المدينه لنفرض سفرتنا عم نطلع حدا يعرف امتى مسافر حدا منكم يعرف امتى مسافرين اوكي وين 15th of september no I'm saying to medina not to lebanon 14th to medina how about the others 14th fine طالعين يوم 14 سبتمبر على المدينه احفظوا التاريخ اللي قلت لكم اياه هو شو 22 لا تنسون 22 keep in mind the date I talked about which is September 22nd حاجة go to the خريطة the map again so let's say we're supposed to go to Medina and that would be on September 14th we fly to Medina هلا يمكن يوم قبل يوم بعد المهم سبتمبر 14 15 16 around this time you will be arriving in Medina now had you go to the second page go to the third page Medina what do we do in Medina شنو فيها المدينة وماذا نزور في المدينة خلينا نمر بسرعة المدينة فيها عدة أماكن مهمة تزار. طبعا قبل هذه بدي أذكركم بشغلة، أول ما نوصل على السعودية، السعوديين شوية صعبين، أخلاقهم تعبانة. طبعا لما أقصد السعوديين مش أقصد الشعب السعودي، لا أقصد حكومة السعودية. When you go to Medina, you expect the worst. There will be some aggravation, there could be long lines waiting for your passport to be cleared. Expect the worst. Expect the worst. Have low expectations. When you fly out of the US going to Saudi Arabia for Hajj, imagine yourself literally going back 200 years back. So expect the worst in Saudi Arabia. Long lines, aggravation, you will be stressed out. In the airport, they may hold you for a long period of time. They are very aggressive. They are not nice with people, whether in the airport or anywhere you go, they are not nice at all, at all. So have low expectations, and please do not engage in any altercation, in any problem with them. Whatever they say to you, tell them fine, shukran. رايحين على السعودية، اتوقعوا رايحين انتو، شو المثل يقول؟ احسن بلاد واسوأ شعب. اتوقعوا انه ما كل شيء راح يكون مريح مثل ما بدكم. When you arrive in Saudi Arabia, Saudis look for three things equally important and dangerous to them. What are these three things? Weapons. None of you will have weapons, right? Weapons and explosives. Number two, drugs. None of you will carry drugs. So you're fine. The third thing, books. They treat books like bombs. So don't take much books with you. Take books that you need. For example, this one. Hajja, can I have a copy? I'm sorry. So take with you what you need for Hajj. مثلا كتاب مفاتيح الجنان, they won't allow it. ضياء الصالحين, they won't allow it. Most religious and non-religious books are banned from Saudi Arabia. Anything Shia is banned. Anything Shia. Only if you are taking a book that exclusively speaks about Hajj only, like this one. Only about Hajj rituals, they allow you. Anything else they will not allow. I advise you to take a copy of this. It is permissible to take it to Saudi Arabia. And also it helps you, especially if you read English. It is an easy read, very easy read. It helps you a lot in understanding Hajj, even though I'm covering almost everything. But it is not a bad idea if you want to read something about Hajj, you read this book, this copy. It is available here, Hajja, and the donation is what, $10? $20 for Islamic Institute of America. طيب. So don't take, other than this book, I don't mean this particular book, anything similar to this, but don't take anything else. Now, once you enter Saudi Arabia, there are a few places must visit. What are these places? The number one place is Masjid al-Rasul. أهم مكان نزوره في المدينة المنورة شو هو؟ مسجد الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. المسجد الذي بناه رسول الله وصلى فيه رسول الله. النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يقول الصلاة في مسجدي بعشرة آلاف صلاة. The Prophet himself says, if you pray one single prayer in my masjid, it will be multiplied as far as reward 10,000 times. Having said this, it doesn't mean if I owe 10,000 prayers, I have not to pray. I go pray, I do one prayer, then I make up for 10,000 prayers. No. I'm not talking about making up. I'm talking about the reward. If you do one single prayer at the Masjid al-Rasul, the reward of the prayer is multiplied 10,000 times, okay? So, visit Masjid al-Rasul. Praying in Masjid al-Rasul, every prayer is multiplied 10,000 times. What else we do? We visit the Prophet, because the shrine of the Prophet is located inside the masjid. The tomb of the Prophet is located. This is the masjid. Let's see a picture of the tomb. So basically that's the drawing. Okay. This is the tomb of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. So you cannot see inside. You can just see the cage. So behind these bars, the Prophet's body is buried. Also, Fatima al-Zahra, there is a possibility, we're not sure, but there is a narration that Fatima al-Zahra also is buried in Masjid al-Rasul. هناك حديث أن الزهراء أيضا النبي طبعا مدفون في المسجد وفاطمة الزهراء عليه السلام هناك رواية أنها مدفونة أيضا في مسجد الرسول صلى الله عليه فطبعا هناك في هذا الكتاب أو أي كتاب في زيارة الرسول وفاطمة الزهراء if you look at page 33, if you have this book, it shows you the ziyara of Rasul, the Prophet, in Arabic and in English, translated in English. Right after that, ziyara, how you address Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam, in Arabic and in English. If you read Arabic, fine. If not, you can read it in English. I'm sure the Ma'arif may send someone with you, but in case you don't have a Ma'arif, the Ma'arif with you, you can go by yourself, take this book with you. Now, there are applications actually on iPhone that has all the ziyarat. I have it in my phone. I don't know if you have it. But of course in Arabic. I have it in Arabic, not in English. So if you can get that application in your cell phone, then you don't need to carry this book at all. So you can just, but we don't have it as an application, right? So anyway, if you don't have the application, then take this book with you. It is allowed. You are allowed to take this book with you. You can read the ziyara from this زيارة الرسول صلى الله عليه وآله هذا المسجد هذا قبر الرسول go to the other picture حجة this is محراب الرسول صلى الله عليه وآله this is the place the prophet used to lead the prayer from and this one is منبر الرسول this is the pulpit from which he would give his sermons and khutbas Go to that. Okay, look at this drawing. اطلعوا هون رجال. هذا مسجد الرسول. هذا كله مسجد الرسول. طبعا مسجد كبير جدا جدا. في مسجد الرسول في منطقة اسمها الروضة. شو الروضة؟ الروضة هو أقدس مكان في مسجد الرسول. اللي هي الفاصلة ما بين منبر الرسول وشو؟ قبر الرسول. The most holiest thing in the Masjid al-Rasul, you can pray anywhere in the Masjid al-Rasul. Everywhere you pray, it is multiplied 10,000 times. But the best and the most holiest part of the Prophet's mosque is what is known as Rawdah. This is the Rawdah. The Rawdah located all the way into the northern part of the Masjid. This is the grave of the Prophet. This is the pulpit of the Prophet, between pulpit and the grave. It is as big as this room. It is as big as this room. That's the most holiest part. If you can just do two rak'ah mustahab, that would be good. That's the most holiest part. هذه أقدس بقعة في مسجد الرسول. النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم نفسه يقول ما بين منبري وقبري روضة من رياض الجنة. ولهذا سميت بالروضة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم himself says between my pulpit and my grave is a piece of paradise. So that's why it's called روضة. روضة is paradise. So try to go. This place is not open for women all the time. They switch between men and women. So I guess after the morning prayer, between 7 a.m. and 11 a.m. it is open for women. Then afternoon they open it from, I guess, 3 to 7 again. So the rest of the time it is open for men only. So women have to go at a specific time. You need to check with your ma'arif. It's not open all the time for you. Women can go in other parts, but they cannot go into this part anytime they want. It has to be after the morning prayer and after Asr prayer. هذا المكان مش مفتوح للنساء على طول. مفتوح فقط بعد صلاة الصبح للظهر وبعد صلاة العصر. بقية الأوقات المكان فقط لمن؟ للرجال. So, هذا المكان الأول اللي مستحب الإنسان يزوره. كم مرة نزوره؟ نزوره كم مرة باليوم؟ أصلاً أنتوا رح تكونون قريبين من مسجد الرسول صلى الله عليه وآله. You will be within walking distance. So instead of praying your morning prayer in the hotel, ظهر عصر in the hotel, go and pray all your prayers in the masjid. The morning prayer, ظهر prayer, عصر prayer, مغرب prayer, عشاء prayer. Now, can I follow the imam there? It depends. If you follow Sayyid Ali al-Khamenei or Sayyid Muhammad Hussein Fadlallah, they say yes, you can follow the imam. It's normal. And it counts for you. Sayyid Ali Sistani says, if you have to follow, you can follow but without intending jama'ah. Meaning you pray simultaneously with them but do not intend jama'ah. Intend you are praying by yourself, but simultaneous. When they go to ruku', you go to ruku' with them. When they go to sujood, you go. But you do your own prayer. That's clear. Hajj, go to the next picture. طيب بعد من الأماكن المهمة في المدينة المنورة هو البقيع. البقيع يضم مراقد الأئمة الأطهار عليهم السلام. الإمام الحسن، الإمام زين العابدين، الإمام محمد الباقر، الإمام جعفر الصادق. Four of our holy imams, out of 12 imams, four of them are buried in Al-Baqi' and in this cemetery, which is not too far from Masjid al-Rasul, within 5 minutes, 5 minutes walking from Masjid al-Rasul. So four imams, Imam Hassan, Imam Zain al-Abidin, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq are all buried here. You go and visit them. Who else is buried? Al-Abbas, Amm al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, the uncle of the Prophet. Who else? Fatima bint Asad, the mother of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. She is buried there too. Who else? The three daughters of the Prophet, Zainab, Ruqayya, Umm Kulthum, the sisters of Fatima al-Zahra, are buried there as well. The wives of the Prophet. Ibrahim, the Prophet had a son, three-year-old son who died while young. He is also buried there. Ibn al-Rasul, Ibrahim, عمره 3 سنوات, أيضا مدفون. وعدد كبير من الصحابة. مستحب زيارة البقيع. لكن في ملاحظة. البقيع مش على طول مفتوح. البقيع يفتح مرتين باليوم. مرة بعد صلاة الصبح لمدة ساعة. مرة بعد صلاة العصر لمدة ساعة. يعني من الساعة 6 للـ 7 صباحا ومن الساعة 4 للـ 5 عصرا مرتين فقط اللي بده يروح يزور بده يروح في الأوقات اللي يكون مفتوح وإلا يكون مسكر فيك تزور الأئمة بس من خارج السور من برا ومفتوح فقط لمن شوفوا هذه صورة من برا مأخوذة بقيع يعني مقبرة كبيرة ومفتوح لمن الرجال فقط بالسعودية المرأة محتقرة أبي يسمحون للمرأة أن تدخل في البقيع. Only men are allowed to go inside بقيع cemetery. Women are not allowed. So if I am a woman and I want to pray, I want to do ziyara, can I do that? Yes, you do it from outside the gate. You know, these are the bars and the gates. So you can stand from outside and do the ziyara. It's fine. And you see, this picture is taken from outside, from behind the bars. You see the graves of our imams, alayhim as-salam. قبر الإمام الصادق, الإمام الحسن, الإمام الباقر, الإمام السجاد. هذه القبور متقاربة. Four graves next to each other. Do we have other pictures, حاجة? Okay. هذه صورة من الإجمالية من فوق. ففي المدينة بدنا نزور مكانين، مسجد الرسول الصلاة فيه كم مرة؟ 10,000. The first place we will be visiting maybe 5 times a day. You're not going to stay in Medina more than 3 to 4 days. That's Masjid al-Rasul. The second place you will be visiting is what? Baqiyah. The third place, المكان الثالث, Masjid, visiting the martyrs of the Battle of Uhud. In the second year of the Hijrah, after the Prophet migrated to Medina, the Kuffar, the infidels, came from Medina, from Mecca to fight with the Prophet and his companions. So in that battle, known as Battle of Uhud, Uhud is the name of mountain, Mount Uhud. So the reason it is called Battle of Uhud, because it is named after the mountain. So in the mountain, do we have the picture of the mountain? So this is Uhud. This is the Mount Uhud. Next to the Mount Uhud, the battle took place. هذا جبل أحد إلى جانب جبل أحد وقعت معركة أحد. في معركة أحد قتل 70 من المسلمين. 70 عدد كبير 70. لأن هم كل المسلمين كانوا يمكن 1,000 بس. قتل 70 من المسلمين ومن أهم من قتل في معركة أحد من؟ حمزة سيد الشهداء عم الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. In the Battle of Uhud, 70 companions of the Prophet were martyred. 70. That's a high number. Because the total number of the warriors, the army did not exceed maybe 1,000. Including the uncle of the Prophet, who was very dear to the Prophet. And the Prophet was so saddened when his uncle was killed, Hamza. Hamza was killed brutally. It's like Daesh does to its victims. Hamza was killed by a man called Wahshi. After he was killed, Hind, the mother of Muawiyah, approached the body. She had a knife in her hand. She cut his nose. She cut his fingers, his toes, and she made a necklace out of the nose, out of the fingers, and she wore the necklace. Not only that, as if that was not enough, she cut his heart, she took the heart out, she tried to eat the heart. When she was chewing, when she could not eat it, she threw it up. هذه قصة هند. أم معاوية ست يزيد بن معاوية. لما قتل حمزة راحت قطعة الأنف, قطعة الأصابع, قطعة أصابع الإيد والقدم, صنعت منها قلادة. ثم شقت القلب واستخرجت القلب والكبد بس ما قدرت تاكلها كبتها. المهم مستحب زيارة شهداء أحد. هلا أكيد المعرف راح ياخذكم. I'm sure the معرف will take you to أحد. So I'm just telling you that this is one of the most important places. This picture is taken from behind bars. You can see the graves. هلا the interesting part is when you go now and you want to do ziyara, you will see Daesh is coming after you. When I say Daesh, I don't mean literally Daesh, the duplicate of Daesh, the Saudis. They will come after you. They will not allow you even to do ziyara. You're not doing anything. You're not doing anything. You have your book. You want to do the ziyara for those martyrs. You will see the Saudi authorities chasing you, shouting at you, harassing you, not to allow you even to read the ziyarah. What does this tell you? When you are visiting the uncle of the Prophet, condemning the murderers of the Prophet's uncle, what does this tell you that when they harass you? It tells you that the Saudis are very sympathetic to the murderers of Hamza, to the infidels who killed Hamza. Anyway, but again, if they come after you, don't engage in any verbal fighting with them. If they tell you leave, leave. Last year we had to do the ziyara inside our bus. We could not get off our bus. We had to stay in our bus. العام الماضي ما قدرنا نعمل الزيارة برا. قعدنا بالباص ومن الباص عملنا الزيارة. go to the next place, Hajjah. The other place is called, did we skip Masjid Quba or what? Quba is first or in order, which one is first? Okay. واحدة من المساجد المستحب زيارتها مسجد القبلتين. شنو هو مسجد القبلتين؟ النبي صلى الله عليه وآله أول ما هاجر إلى المدينة كان يصلي باتجاه وين؟ باتجاه بيت المقدس. لفترة كان يصلي باتجاه بيت المقدس. كان يصلي في هذا المسجد لما نزل عليه جبرائيل وقال له غير القبلة من مسجد من بيت المقدس إلى مكة. غير اتجاهه 180 درجة. يعني كان يصلي هذا بيت المقدس، غير اتجاهه في أثناء الصلاة، صلى باتجاه مكة. في صلاة واحدة النبي صلى إلى وين؟ إلى قبلتين. أول الصلاة إلى بيت المقدس، آخر الصلاة إلى مكة. هلا إحنا طبعا لما نروح نصلي بأي اتجاه؟ أكيد نصلي باتجاه مكة. So there is a significant masjid called Masjid al-Qiblatayn, the masjid with two qibla. Why it is called the masjid with two qibla? Because right inside that masjid, the qibla was changed. When the Prophet migrated to Medina, for a few years he was praying to Jerusalem. His qibla was Jerusalem. Then while he was praying, right during his prayer, Jibreel came down and instructed him to turn 180 degrees toward Mecca. And ever since, Muslims started to pray toward Mecca, and that's why we pray toward Mecca. In the beginning, Muslims used to pray toward Jerusalem. So that's why it's called Masjid al-Qiblatayn. Because in one prayer, in one single prayer, the Prophet prayed to both Jerusalem and to Mecca. But of course, when we go now, we pray toward Mecca. It is mustahab. Another مسجد مسجد الإمام علي مسجد فاطمة الزهراء مسجدان صغيران في المدينة طبعا الآن ما فيكم تزوروهم لا مسكريهم الوهابيين مسكريهم you cannot visit مسجد small مسجد إمام علي built for his wife small مسجد he built for himself so both مسجدs are closed down now you cannot go the Wahhabis do not allow you to go near the مسجد so forget about it If they were open, you would have went and visited and did two rak'ah prayer. Now, the other significant place is Masjid Quba. What is the significance of Masjid Quba? Masjid Quba huwa awwalu masjidin buniya fil Islam. Lianu Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi lama bu'itha nabiyan kan fi Mecca. Mecca ma kan fi ibni masjid. لما اجى على المدينه قبل لا يوصل على المدينه مر على قريه اسمها قبا قبا تبعد 6 كيلومترات عن المدينه بنى فيها اول مسجد مسجد قبا is the first masjid built in Islam because remember when the prophet was sent as a messenger he was not allowed to build any masjid due to the persecution of Meccans when he migrated to Medina before even entering Medina He passed by a village called Quba and he built Masjid Quba. Now it is almost within Medina. 14 centuries ago, it was outside Medina, a village outside Medina. Right? Now it's right inside Medina. 6 kilometers of the Haram, of the shrine of the Prophet. So you go and visit Masjid Quba. Now, keep in mind, Hadith Sahih an Rasulullah, يرويه السنة والشيعة. عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله يقول من توضأ في بيته وأتى مسجد قبى وصلى فيه صلاة أعطي ثواب عمره The Prophet says if you make wudu at home in the hotel and you come to Masjid Quba and pray two rak'ah one prayer, one single prayer, mustahab two rak'ah Allah will give you the reward of Umrah, as if you have performed Umrah. So you must go to this place. Because praying two rak'ah in this masjid is equivalent to the reward of what? Umrah. So this is another significant place you need to visit. I'm sure the Ma'arif will take you there. هذا من الأماكن المهمة أيضا مستحب الإنسان يزورها. طيب خلي نروح الآن للحج. قعدنا بالمدينة تقريبا ثلاثة أو أربعة أيام. We stayed in Medina 3 to 4 days. We visited the shrine of the Prophet. We went to the Baqi, Masjid Quba, Uhud, everywhere. Now Hajj starts. So far, it was a vacation. Nothing mandatory. Hajj has not started yet. The last day you are in Medina, your Hajj starts. The last day you are in Medina, your Hajj will start. So Hajj, keep in mind, Hajj is made of two parts. Do we have the picture that shows two parts of Hajj or no Hajj? Okay, go back to the same page. Hajj, listen to me carefully here. It's very important. الحج أعزائي واحد لما يقول أنا رحت على الحج الحج قسمين قسمين قسم صغير قسم كبير القسم الصغير يبلش يوم اللي نطلع من وين من المدينة نجي على مكة يبلش ذاك اليوم وينتهي بعد ما نجي المكة بثلاث ساعات اسمه شو اسمه عمرة التمتع عمرة التمتع هذا القسم الصغير اسم الكبير يبلش يوم 22 سبتمبر اللي قلت لكم عنه إذا تتذكرون يبلش يوم 22 سبتمبر ذاك حج التمتع عمرة التمتع حج التمتع كلاهما يشكلان ماذا؟ حج حجة الإسلام Remember, I said when you guys go to Hajj, especially the first timers, how many of you are first timers going to Hajj? Almost most of you. You will be performing Hajj, حجة الإسلام. Your mandatory Hajj. Hajj is divided into two types. There are two types of Hajj. One called Hajj al-Ifrad, one called Hajj al-Tamattu'. What is the difference between Hajj al-Ifrad and Hajj al-Tamattu'? In Hajj al-Ifrad, you don't kill a sheep, you don't sacrifice. But in Hajj al-Tamattu', you do kill a sheep. Now, who is entitled to do Hajj Ifrad? Who is entitled to do Hajj Tamattu? The residents of Mecca only would do what? Hajj Ifrad. Other people do what? Hajj Tamattu. So when you go to Mecca, what do? Hajj Tamattu. That means you have to kill a sheep. But if you are a Meccan, if you reside in Mecca, if you are local in Mecca, you do your Hajj without killing sheep. So, we have nothing to do with Hajj al-Ifrad simply because all of those who are going from Dearborn will have to do what? Hajj al-Tamattu. الحج قسمين حج إفراد وحج تمتع. حج الإفراد لأهل مكة. بما أنه ولا واحد منكم من أهل مكة فأنتوا رحتوا تأدون حج التمتع. طيب نجي لحج التمتع. حج التمتع ينقسم إلى قسمين. عمرة التمتع و حج التمتع الحج اللي رحتوا تأدوه راح ينقسم إلى قسمين عمرة التمتع حج التمتع The Hajj that you will be performing is divided into two sections a minor section minor part a major part You will be embarking on the minor part of Hajj the day you leave from Medina You go to Mecca, you do Umrah, you finish. That's the minor part of Hajj. And it is called what? Umrah al-Tamattu. Then you stay in Mecca till September 22nd. That's when you start what? Hajj al-Tamattu. So indeed, your Hajj is a combination of two parts. A minor part, a major part. Umrah al-Tamattu, Hajj al-Tamattu. The day you leave Medina to Mecca, you will be performing what? Umrah al-Tamattu. You go to Mecca, you perform Umrah al-Tamattu. I'm going to talk about Umrah al-Tamattu. Then it will take you 2 to 3 hours to finish it. Then you stay in Mecca, nothing else. Then you wait till September 22nd when you have to start your Hajj al-Tamattu. Okay. Umrah. احنا اليوم الاخير في المدينه بدنا نروح على مكه. The last day of your stay in Medina, you will be starting حجه عمرة التمتع, which is the first part of your Hajj. That day, you will be told by your ma'arif to be ready by 3 p.m. So by 3 p.m., you all have to be ready. What I mean by being ready is you have to wear your ihram, you have to take the shower first, do ihram, then go down to take the bus to go to Medina. So the first thing you need to do is what? Take a shower. Is taking shower mandatory or recommended? Recommended. So if you skip it, it's not a big deal. But it is highly recommended that when you want to start your Hajj, you start with taking a shower. The shower, you wash, you have to make the intention that I do ihram for Umrah al-Tamattu', Hajj al-Tamattu', Hajj al-Islam, Qurbatan ila Allah. اغتسل لإحرام عمرة التمتع حج التمتع حج الإسلام قربة لله. You don't have to utter it, you can say it in your heart. You wash your head and neck first, then the right side of your body, then the left side of your body. الرأس والرقبة أولا, الجانب الأيمن الجانب الأيسر. خلصنا من شو؟ من الإحرام من الاغتسال. We are done with the ghusl, with the shower. You put your إحرام on. If you're a man, all you will be using two pieces, two towels, big white towels. Now, as far as I know, 90% of the groups going to Hajj, they will give you your ihram. So don't worry about obtaining your ihram. Your ma'arif will give you your piece of ihram. I know Hajj Hassan does that. Subuh, Hajj Nasif does. Hajj Hassan Hammoud does. I don't know about the groups from Lebanon, but most likely you will be given your ihram, piece of ihram by your ma'arif. Now, let's say he didn't give you. What do you do? It's not the end of the world. In Medina, any store in Medina you go, they sell it to you as cheap as $10. $10. So it's not a big deal. Don't buy anything from here. Don't burden yourself with anything. Go to Medina, either your ma'arif most likely will give you your ihram, or if he didn't, you go to any store in Medina, you tell them, I need ihram. They sell you, it's 45 riyal, 50 riyal maximum, 10, 15 dollars, no more. It's two towels, big two towels. You wear them, one in the middle, one on your shoulder. Are you allowed to wear socks? No. I'm talking about men now. I will get to women. About men, you cannot wear socks. You cannot wear underwear. You cannot wear anything besides these two pieces. Anything. Anything, anything. Only two pieces. Now, how do you hold them? How do you hold, especially the one in the middle, how do you hold it? How do you hold the towel? There is a special belt sold in Medina. They call it Himyan. You buy that Himyan from Medina. It's 10 riyal, meaning $3. You buy that one and you cover yourself with that. So you have your Himyan, you have your towel on your back, your towel in the middle, and your Himyan. Now, the Himyan has pockets. So you can put your personal belongings, your money, your personal belongings in that pocket, since you have no other pockets. Okay, that's for men. For women, what do they wear? You wear your regular clothes for Salah. The same one that you wear for Salah, you wear. It should not be revealing. Should not have any adornment. What I mean by adornment is you see how sometimes you wear something stylish, you know, fancy, has, you know, sparkles, nothing. It has to be completely plain. Completely plain. No zina in it at all. It's not stylish. It has to be very, very simple. Clothes, just like salah, when you do your salah. That's for women. Women can wear socks, no problem. They have to actually cover themselves. Now, men are wearing their ihram, they took shower, men are wearing their ihram, women are wearing their ihram. Hajj has not started yet. Remember, Hajj has not started yet. We go back, we go down, we take the bus. The bus takes us from the hotel to a place called Masjid al-Shajara. Remember I talked about imaginary gates to Mecca? Masjid al-Shajara is a gate to Mecca, meaning if you want to go to Mecca, do Hajj or Umrah, you have to go through Masjid al-Shajara. You cannot just go higher. You have to go inside Masjid al-Shajara and start your Hajj off from Masjid al-Shajara. نركب الباصات ونطلع نروح لوين؟ على مسجد الشجرة قريب مسجد الشجرة مش بعيد عن المدينة 10 دقائق بالسيارة It's not too far 10 minutes ندخل مسجد الشجرة وهناك يبدأ الحج الحج يبدأ في وين في مسجد الشجرة كيف يبدأ الحج شو قلنا قلنا ان الحج ينقسم الى قسمين عمرة التمتع وحج التمتع حج عمرة التمتع راح تتبلش وين في مسجد الشجرة The first part of your Hajj, the minor part of your Hajj will start in Masjid al-Shajara. So you are already wearing your Ihram. You're ready to start your Hajj. Now, when I want to start my Hajj, I have to be completely ready. And the first thing I do the intention, niyyah. So I'm going to say the niyyah. You repeat after me. You repeat after me. So we are all ready now. We are all ready to do the niyyah and start our Hajj, right? قلنا جاهزين الآن حتى نعمل النية. النية هذه أحرم. Repeat after me. أحرم لعمرة التمتع حج التمتع حج الإسلام قربة إلى الله تعالى. If you want to say it in English, you can say it in English. I do إحرام for عمرة التمتع حج التمتع حج الإسلام قربة إلى الله. واجب is not واجب. No, the word واجب is not. I do إحرام for عمرة التمتع حج التمتع. حج الإسلام. Why حج الإسلام? Remember, that's your mandatory حج. Seeking closeness to Allah. You can say it. It's mustahab that you say it, you utter it. But if you don't say it with your tongue, you say it in your heart. So that's the first thing you do. You do what? نية. Intention. أول شيء نعمله هو شو؟ النية. الشيء الثاني طبعاً لازم نعمل النية وين؟ بقلب المسجد. بداخل المسجد. We have to go inside the masjid and do the niyyah. What I mean by inside the masjid, you cannot do the niyyah in the courtyard. You have to go inside the masjid. Unless you're a woman and you have your excuse, then you do it at the courtyard. You do the niyyah at the courtyard because you're not allowed to enter the masjid. Other than a woman with excuse with her monthly cycle, Everybody else should go inside the masjid and do the niyyah inside the masjid. Is that clear? Right. After doing the niyyah, what else I need to do? I need to do the talbiyah. Hajj, can you show us? Go back, Hajj, go back. Okay. So, let me give you a brief idea about Umrat al-Tamattu', what we are going to do. Very brief. When we do the niyyah, we will be doing the talbiyah right after that. After doing the talbiyah, I will help you with talbiyah. We drive to where? To Mecca. The trip may take between 5 to 7 hours. It depends on the traffic, on other things. 5 to 7 hours. Once you go to Mecca, you will be going home. You will be resting for a while. Half an hour, 1 hour. Then you will be going where? From your hotel, going where? To the masjid, the Kaaba, where the Kaaba is. You go there, you do four things. You do tawaf around the Kaaba. After doing the tawaf around the Kaaba, you do two rak'ah of tawaf behind Maqam Ibrahim. I will explain that. After doing the two rak'ah, you go and do sa'i between Safa and Marwa, walking between Safa and Marwa. After doing walking between Safa and Marwa, you cut a little bit of your hair, man and woman. And then that's it. Your umrah is over. أول ما نجي على مسجد الشجرة رحنا ننوي نية الإحرام بعد نية الإحرام راح نعمل التلبية بعد التلبية نركب بالباص نجي على وين؟ على مكة أول شيء نروح على الهوتيل نحط الشنط نتوضأ نجي على وين؟ على المسجد الحرام حيث الكعبة نعمل طواف بعد الطواف ركعتي الطواف بعد ركعتي الطواف السعي بين الصفا والمروة وبعد السعي بين الصفا والمروة الحلق التقصير انتهت العمرة خلصنا. So let's go back. Now after I did the niyya, I need to do what? The talbiyah. So Hajj, go to the talbiyah. After we did the niyya, after I said أحرم لعمرة التمتع حج الإسلام قربة لله, immediately I have to do the talbiyah. The talbiyah in Arabic is this: لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك. The translation: Yes, Your Highness. Allah, Yes, Your Highness. You have no partner. All praise and glory is to You, as well as Your kingdom. I bear witness that you have no partner. Yes, Your Highness. This is what it means. So what does it mean to say yes, Your Highness? Allah invited you to Hajj, you are fulfilling His invitation. So when Allah invited you to Hajj, you are saying labbaik. You invited me, I'm fulfilling your invitation. You're talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first thing you do, the talbiyah. After doing the niyyah, you do the talbiyah. It's must. And by the way, you have to do it in excellent Arabic. No mistake is tolerated. If you have difficulty doing the talbiyah, reading the talbiyah, we have now, today is what? Today is August what? 25. You have all the way till September 15th. So you have almost, you know, 20 days to practice. Enough time to practice. But make sure when you say it, no mistake at all. I'm going to read the talbiyah. You read it with me. You repeat after me. أنا أقرأ التلبية وأنتم تقرأون من بعدي. عندكم وقت من الآن إلى يوم وصولكم إلى وين؟ إلى مسجد الشجرة. تعلموا أنه ما تعملوا ولا غلطة أبدا. مش مقبولة الغلطة فيها. يجب أن تقرأ صحيحا التلبية بدون أي خطأ. فأنا الآن أقرأ وأنتم تقرؤون بعدي. لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك. Make sure that you say it just the way I said it, without any mistake. So for example, when you say la sharik, you have to say la sharik. You cannot say la sharik. La sharik. See the difference? في ناس تقول لا شريك. لا شريك. شريك هذا شريك بالمحطة. هون بدك تقول لا شريك. مش لا شريك. ما في خطأ. لازم تقرأها بالشكل الصحيح. بدون أي خطأ. بدأ حدا يجرب حظه ويقرأها. نشوف كيف. حجة يلا تفضل. لا. لبيك اللهم. ما نقول لبيك اللهم. لبيك اللهم. لا حاجة. لا عفوا. لبيك اللهم. اسمعوني مرتين، شوفوا، لبيك اللهم، مش لبيك اللهم، الآية ما تلفظها، لبيك اللهم. أحسنتي حجة، أحسنتي. حدا ثاني بده يجرب؟ Anyone else wants to try? Okay. No, you cannot say it in English. It has to be said in Arabic. You can read the translation, but you have to say it in Arabic. I'm going to say it one more time, and we will move on. Please repeat after me. لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك. Not all of you are reading. Only half of you are reading. Please, all of you. I want to hear all of you. Out loud. لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك. Those who have difficulty, they can practice, and it is in this book as well, so you can read it. And make sure when you get to Masjid al-Shajara, you pronounce it correctly. Any question about Talbiyah? One time, mandatory. Recommended, it has no maximum. You can say it 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 times, till you arrive in where? In Mecca. So you have 7 or 8 hours traveling to Mecca, it is mustahab that you keep repeating the talbiyah. One time, mandatory, but many times, mustahab, it has no maximum. As many times as you can. Wait. After we did the talbiyah, now we became what? We became muhrim. Muhrim. Officially, we are in the state of ihram. Officially, we are in the state of ihram. It's a very holy state, very holy state. Once I'm in the state of ihram, I did the niyyah and the talbiyah, there are 26 things become haram on me. 26 things. Listen, some of these things are not so relevant today. They used to be relevant 100 years ago, but not today. For example, hunting. No one is going to hunt, right? But in the past, people used to hunt because that was the only way for them to survive. Now, you're driving. The drive takes you 5-6 hours. You don't need to hunt. If you need to eat, the bus will stop and there are restaurants you can eat. So you will notice some of these 26 things are not so relevant today. In other words, you are not going to do them anyway. In the past, they were relevant. But some of them are relevant, meaning you might be exposed to do them. لما عملنا النية والتلبية 26 شغلة صارت حرام علي. هلا بعض الأشياء أنتم ما رح تعملوها anyway. مثل الصيد، أحد منكم رح يصيد. بس في شغلات الحاج رح يعملها ورح تأذكرها. مثلا على سبيل المثال كلمة والله. في ناس كل ما حكى قال والله وما عم يكذب والله رحنا والله أثناء الإحرام لا يجوز لك أن تقول والله صادقا أم كاذبا. You cannot say the word والله while you are in the ihram. Even if you're honest, you're not lying. Do not use the word والله at all. What if you do? If you do it once, you're doing haram. You do it twice, you're doing haram. But if you do it 3 times, you have to kill a sheep. If you do it 6 times, you have to kill 2 sheep. If you do it 9 times, you have to do it, you have to kill 3 sheep. If you do it 12, so on. So some people have the habit of saying wallah. By the time they finish their hajj, they have to order a ship from New Zealand full of sheep and kill them. You're talking about $150, $200, yes. as much as the sheep cost. So, انتبهوا يا إخوان يا أخوات يا إخوان يا أخوات خصوصا العرب للأمريكان ما بيعرفوا والله كل ما حكى قال والله العام كان واحد معي بالحج كل ما حكى قال والله يا عمي أسكت يقول ما فيني لا كل ما أحكي أقول والله أقول له عمي أحسن شي جيب شريط حط على تمك أسكت أحسن لك لما بس يحكي يورط حاله فأنا برأيي أحسن شي الواحد ما بيصير عليه كفارة شي يسوي يسكر تمه مع الاحترام The best thing you do is to keep your mouth I'm sorry to say shut Don't talk because the minute you open your mouth There is a possibility you will do something haram. And I'm going to mention things that are haram during the ihram. Lying is haram. Bragging is haram. Bragging about anything during ihram is haram. So there are many things that if you do during the ihram, so that you're better off either not saying anything, keeping quiet, or if you want to say something, say talbiyah. Repeat the talbiyah. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Read Quran, read dua. Say something. يعني آيات, Quran, something. But don't engage in any nonsense conversation. So there are 26 things that become haram immediately after we start our ihram. Number one, hunting. الصيد. Number two, intercourse. Someone has intercourse with his wife. Haram. Kiss your spouse. تقبيل الزوجة أو الزوج أثناء الإحرام. حرام. Touch spouse with lust. لمس الزوجة. هلا إذا لمسها بقصد ينزلها من الباص ما في مشكلة. بس إذا لمسها بشهوة حرام. If a husband touches his wife because he wants to help her to get into the bus, that's not haram. But touching your spouse with lust is haram. Look at spouse with lust. Looking at my wife with lust is haram. Same thing, a wife looking at her husband during ihram with lust, not love, with lust is haram. النظر إلى الزوجة والزوج أثناء الإحرام بقصد الشهوة حرام. ستة, masturbation is haram during. Now when I say haram, well, masturbation is haram anyway in Islam. But there would be a big, huge kafara. It amounts to killing not a sheep, rather a camel, and coming to Hajj next year again. If you do one of these things. Masturbation. Al-istimna, haram. Performing marriage. What is performing marriage? يعني واحد يكتب كتابة في الحج. It's irrelevant today, صحيح؟ بس بالزمانات لأنه الناس كانت تسافر مع بعض هذه مرة كانت مش محرم عليه ويطلع معها فكان يضطر يعمل عقد عليهم للحلال والحرام ألا أنتم مش مضطرين تعملون هالشغلة الحمد لله So performing marriage is irrelevant these days but it was in the past This is relevant Very relevant Perfume تعطر أثناء الإحرام حرام ما فيك تحط عطر You cannot use perfume. Actually, not only perfume. Anything that has good scent, you cannot use. So, for example, toothbrush or teeth brush. When you brush your teeth, you use the toothpaste. It cannot be with scent. It has to be something and scented. There is. Yes. Every time you wash your hand, the soap can have to be what? And scented. Watch out. Don't use any soap that is scented. Anytime you use the shampoo, it has to be unscented. I'm sorry? The Umrah is not big. It's you're talking about almost a day or half a day. But the problem is where in Hajj, the other part. So if you use the soap, it has to be unscented. Kleenex or napkin, mostly is scented in Saudi Arabia. So if you need to use napkin, make sure it is not scented. No perfume, no scented objects at all during Ihram. No lotion. Hala, we're coming to the lotion, Hajj. رحنا نحكي عن اللوشن. بس هلا عم نحكي عن التعطر. لا تعطر إطلاقا. ما في شي ريحة طيبة أبدا أبدا. Even more, if you smell a bad smell, you see how naturally you block your nose? You cannot do that. So if you smell something bad while you're in the state of ihram, you cannot block your nose. Allah is testing your patience. طيب. Number 9. التعطر رقم 8. رقم 9. للرجال فقط. Only for men. To wear anything sewn. أخير. You can. رقم 10. للنساء والرجال. الكحل. تكحل. Number 10. Eyeliner or كحل. Whether for men, well, usually men don't put kuhat, but just assuming, men and women, they cannot apply kuhul or eyeliner. They cannot. Why? Because remember, this is trip, worship, not a vacation. You're not in a vacation. ما رايح لتنبسط. ما في كحل. حتى الكحل العربي. داعش. النظر في المرآة ما بيجوز تطلع في المراية أبدا أثناء الإحرام أبدا أبدا إلا إذا أنا انجرحت مثلا بدي أشوف الجرح أما بدي أطلع أشوف حالي ما بيجوز الإزاز أحيانا أنت قاعد حد الإزاز تبع السيارة ما فيك تشوف حالك بس الكاميرا فيني أشوف فيها ولا لا نعم ليش لأنه مش مراية كاميرا فيني هلا شوفوا هاي الكاميرا إيش في واحد يصور حاله فيها؟ فإذا صورت حالي ما في إشكال لأن هذه شو؟ مش مراية، هاي مش مراية. المراية سواء بالإزاز أو المراية العادية ما فيك. You cannot look in the mirror at all. So, but using the camera, the iPhone camera, it's fine because it's not a mirror. Looking in the mirror, it's haram while you are in the state of ihram. نعم حاج. خطأ يزيح عينك يستغفر الله نعم ما في if you accidentally happen to be looking at the mirror it just happens sometime you enter the elevator and there is mirror so you need to lower your gaze immediately and say استغفار don't look هذه شوية صعبة لأنه وين ما تروح في مراية everywhere you go there are mirrors you have to watch for this رقم 12 للرجال فقط مش للنساء شو ان يلبس الرجل الكلسات او الحذاء ما بيجوز men cannot wear socks at all they cannot wear shoes so what do they wear they wear slippers don't bother yourself when you go to Medina you can buy them from Medina You can buy them from here if you want, but in Medina, they are everywhere. You can buy them from Medina. I'm sorry? No leather. Plastic, yes. So, halla. Part of the cover has to be open. Yes, for the man. For the man, part of the cover has to be open. So, number 13. رقم 13 الفسوق وما هو الفسوق؟ الفسوق هو الكذب القسم والتفاخر عفوا الكذب السب والتفاخر هذا اسم الفسوق فمن حج البيت فلا رفث ولا فسوق الحج So there is no فسوق What is fusuq? Haram. Fusuq is haram during extra haram, actually. There is kafara for it. During ihram. What is fusuq? To lie, to swear at someone, to brag about something. This is called fusuq. You cannot. So to lie, you know, someone is lying. Well, lying in Islam is haram anyway, but during ihram, it will be extra haram and you have to pay kafara. To swear at someone, this is very relevant, because sometimes you get aggravated. I'm going to mention that when you do tawaf, sometimes you are squeezed out, you are pushed. Someone comes in from behind and squeezes you or pushes you. You need to, you know, maintain your patience. Do not erupt. Don't swear at anyone. Even if someone insults you, you cannot swear during ihram. Allah is testing your patience. Be very careful. Don't swear at anyone. Even if someone swears at you, you cannot swear back. Do not brag about anything. 14. Al-mujadalah. Al-jidal. شو المقصود بالجدال؟ أن تقول والله. To say والله. والله I did, والله I didn't. As I mentioned before, saying والله is haram. If you say it three times, there is a sheep. After each third time, there is a sheep. So on number three, there is sheep. Number six, two sheep. Number nine, three sheep, and so on and so forth. So please make sure you do not say wallah and get an argument during hajj, during ihram, I mean, ihram. Number 15, أن تقتل الحشرات حتى لو كانت القمل. أي حشرة ما بيجوز واحد يقتلها. While you are in the ihram, you cannot kill no insect. No insect at all. So if you see an ant, you cannot kill it. Even lice, if it comes to you, you cannot. Mosquito, you cannot. So if you see a mosquito here, you cannot kill her or kill it. What do? You remove it gently. You kiss it. You tell her, I love you. And then you put her somewhere safe. I'm joking, of course. No, I'm joking. What I mean, you cannot kill. You cannot kill no insect. No mosquito, no animal at all. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be very peaceful, even with insects. وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا. Complete peace. You do not harm anyone. Not human beings, even animals, even insects. Don't touch them. The only insect that you are allowed to kill is, God forbid, if you see a scorpion or a snake, you can kill them. Protect yourself, right? But other than that, leave all animals, insects, you know, unharmed. نترك الحشرات ما لنا شغل فيها. رقم 16 مهم انتبهوا مهم جدا أعزائي رقم 16 و17 انتبهوا. What time is it? Okay, we have 10 more minutes. تعبتوا ها? You're tired? الله يخليكم. We have 10 minutes. Inshallah, we'll cover them. Adornment, التزيين. أي شيء زينة ما بيجوز. فإذا أنا لابس ساعة رولكس للزينة يجوز ألبسها أثناء الإحرام؟ لا. إذا مرة رايحة وحاملة الصيغة تبعها يجوز؟ لا. أثناء الإحرام ما بيجوز. أي شيء للزينة ما بيجوز. بس إذا أنا ألبس ساعة مش للزينة لأشوف الوقت. خواتم يجوز إذا كانت للزينة ما بيجوز بس إذا للاستحباب الشرعي حدا يلبس العقيق مستحب ما في إشكال. If I'm wearing rings, what is my intention? If my intention to beautify myself, it's haram. I have to remove them while in the ihram. But if my intention is to wear عقيق because عقيق is مستحب Islamically to wear, that's fine. Anything for adornment. Remember, when women are wearing their ihram, no adornment should be, no design, nothing. It has to be completely plain. No adornment. 14. حاجة أنت سألتي عن اللوشن. ما بيجوز اللوشن. أي مادة دهنية ما بيجوز. You cannot apply lotion. You cannot apply lotion. Now, what if you have to? Medically, you have to. Let's say there are people who are sensitive from sun, and they have to apply. Medically, they have to. They are not doing this just out of pleasure, but they have to. Now there's difference in opinion. Some scholars, نعم. هلا عم أقول إذا الإنسان استعمل اللوشن إذا كان مضطر، إذا مش مضطر ما بيجوز استعمل اللوشن. إذا كان مضطر السيد السيستاني يقول حتى لو كنت مضطر ما عليك شيء. الله ما بيقول لك شيء. سامح. السيد فضل الله نفس الشيء. بس السيد الخوئي يقول لك حتى لو مضطر معليش استعمله بس بدك تدفع كفارة تذبح خروف. So if you have to apply lotion, سيد سيستاني and سيد فضل الله, they say it's fine. If it's a medical necessity, it's fine. But for example, سيد خوئي says, it's okay, it's not haram. It's not a sin to apply lotion if you have to, but then you have to kill a sheep. So if it's not a necessity, for sure it's haram. If it's not a necessity. Like, شو اسمه هذا deodorant. You cannot apply deodorant during ihram. Shaving. الحلق أثناء الإحرام ما بيجوز. إزالة الشعر أثناء الإحرام ما بيجوز. ما بيجوز حرام. فالإنسان أثناء الإحرام ما بيجوز ليزيل لا شعرة واحدة ولا عشرة ولا عشرين. While in the ihram you cannot shave, you cannot remove hair at all. Any hair from the your body. You cannot shave it during the ihram. Before the ihram, before you go to the ihram, you can shave. But not during ihram. Not when you are in the state of ihram. للرجال, number 19 is only for men. Covering their head. You cannot wear lafa during ihram. You cannot wear hat. You cannot wear anything on your head. Your head has to be bare, exposed. You cannot wear anything on your head if you're a man. If you're a man. It doesn't matter. Say it, Sheikh, you cannot wear. You have to remove it, yes. Okay. رقم 19 تغطية الرأس للرجل ما بيجوز أثناء الإحرام. رقم 20 طبعا الحمد لله هذا النسوان ديربن مش مبتلين به, نسوان السعودية مبتلين. For women to cover their face. Well, and if you cover your face? Only in Saudi Arabia they do. نعم. نعم. حجة فهمت عليك أختك إذا لبست الطائية لبس الطائية مش حرام بس إذا نزلت الطائية بحيث إجي على وجهها على رأسها هون ما بيجوز بس إذا مظللة يعني عم تلبسها الظل عم يجي ما في إشكال تغطية وجهها في إشكال بس لتلبس شيء على رأسها بحيث الظل يحميها لحميها للظل ما في إشكال طيب Women cannot cover their face during ihram. Okay, so this is almost irrelevant here in Michigan. Okay, men going under shade while traveling, they cannot do that. While traveling from Medina to Mecca, you cannot go under shade. So what do I do with the bus when I'm traveling? Okay, there are two exceptions. Or actually one major exception. If you travel at night, if you follow Sayyid Fadlallah or Sayyid Ali Sistani, they say if you travel at night, you're okay. And that's why most, or I can say all the groups who travel from Medina to Mecca, what time they travel? At night, after sunset. So you're fine. But if the bus gets delayed, till after sunrise, the Ma'arif may not tell you that you have to pay the kafar. It happened years ago. The bus got delayed, and men arrived in Mecca after 7 or 8 a.m. The Ma'arif did not tell them. So I had to tell them that you had to pay kafara. Now, who has to pay the kafara, myself or the Ma'arif? Well, the Hujjaj were saying it's not our fault, it is the Ma'arif. The Ma'arif says, no, it's not my fault. But the bottom line, you have to pay kafara. So if the Arif did not pay it, you have to pay it. You have to kill a sheep. Sheep, yes. Yes. But hopefully they will be arriving before sunset. So those who travel at night, you have enough time. But just in case, if you got stuck, that you arrive in Mecca, you arrive in Mecca after sunrise, you are in the bus and it's shaded, then you have to kill a sheep. Well, it doesn't have to be in Mecca. You can come to Michigan, you can do it in Lebanon. Okay. رقم التضليل، التضليل للرجال أثناء السفر حرام، ما بيجوز. ولذلك بس بالليل عند السيد السيستاني والسيد فضل الله، إذا سافرت بالليل يجوز، ما في إشكال. بس بالنهار والسيد علي الخامنئي أيضا. سيد علي الخامنئي نفس الشيء. صار الوقت. We have 5 minutes. خلي let's finish. So tomorrow we talk about the Umrah. رقم 22 أخذ الدم. ما بيجوز إنسان يأخذ دم. إخراج الدم من الجسد أثناء الإحرام ما بيجوز. To take blood. See, when I say take blood, it means intentionally. But if something happens unintentionally, I bleed unintentionally, that does not harm my Haram. But if I cause my skin to bleed, then it is haram. Number 23. قص الأظافر أثناء الإحرام ما بيجوز. To clip your nail during إحرام is haram. رقم 24. None of you, I guess, is planning to do that. To take a tooth out. So you're not going to take a tooth out during إحرام. I'm almost sure of that. Number 25, حمل السلاح. Well, I don't think you can carry weapon these days. If you do, they will take you to Guantanamo Bay before you get to Mecca. So this is, again, I think it's irrelevant. But just to keep in mind, you cannot carry weapon while you're in the state of ihram. These 25 things become haram on you as soon as you start your ihram. When you say, labbaik Allahumma labbaik, then these 25 become haram on you. When this taboo prohibition will be removed, when you are done with your Umrah, inshallah, tomorrow, is it tomorrow? Tomorrow we will be explaining Umrah and Hajj, inshallah. So please, most likely we'll be having two more sessions, most likely. Tuesday and Wednesday and next Monday. Please make sure you attend these two sessions. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sunglasses for women is okay, as long as they are not wearing them for adornment. As long as they are not wearing them to look sexy. But if they wear them just for protection, that's fine. For men and women, it doesn't matter.